Okay, thank you, colleagues, and we'll continue to the last item of business this evening. And before doing so, can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus. And the final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 1137 in the name of Jamie Halker-Johnson on recognising the importance of Scotland's ferry services. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. And I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Jamie Halker-Johnson, who is joining us remotely, to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I apologise for not being able to attend this evening. Can I thank all those members who supported my motion and made this evening's debate possible? And can I also thank all those who work across our ferry network, the crews, the engineers, mechanics, catering, shoreside and others, those who over the last few years have often in extremely difficult circumstances worked so hard to keep services running where they can, despite facing growing challenges. I'm an islander. My home is just one of 90 inhabited islands in Scotland, each with their own rich cultural heritage. And these communities are valued parts of our nation. They remind us of Scotland's internal diversity, that we are a place of many traditions. But they are also living communities, communities of people who depend on our transport links, just as much for finding sustainable work, reaching a hospital appointment, or visiting friends and family as anyone on the mainland. And to bring people, services, and supplies to our islands as well, because no island is fully self-sufficient, nor exists in isolation. And many characteristics of the islands are shared by remote mainland communities too, whether that's Noida, dubbed Britain's last wilderness, or the Kintyre Peninsula, divided in its own way by the sea. And the importance of our transport links to each other, to the rest of Scotland and the UK, and to the wider world cannot be overstated. They are our lifelines. And the communities dependent on our ferries also remind us of our fragility. For much of our history, the rural highlands and islands, in common with other parts of remote and rural Scotland, have faced the threat of depopulation. Some have not survived. Islands like Kilda and Stroma, you can see the echoes of societies that have been lost, the abrupt end of human stories that had endured often against the odds for centuries. And I say this as a reminder of just how important it is that we get the operation of our lifeline links right. And because regrettably, these things are currently going so very wrong. Today, we see a ferry crisis that has been unprecedented in its impact and still rumbles on with little sign of abating. Communities have been cut off at a time when their economic recovery following the worst periods of the COVID-19 pandemic is most needed. If it was Glasgow or Edinburgh that faced such challenges, it would be considered a national emergency, a national scandal even. Even at the height of this crisis in the summer, our calls for a statement from the Scottish Government were rejected because we were told the Transport Minister was on holiday. Now, the Transport Minister is very entitled to a holiday, but surely the Secretary, his boss, could have stepped in. Such a dismissive response from the Scottish Government suggested Edinburgh really wasn't taking the growing issue seriously. And that was disappointing because in the last session of this Parliament, there were some signs that this Scottish Government was, albeit belatedly, starting to recognise the unique challenges our islands face. Partial support for our inter-island ferry in Orkney and Shetland, albeit with annual fights for funding, the extension of RET, although again in Orkney, as far as the Scottish Government is concerned, they're now 3 years overdue on meeting their own pledge. We also saw an Islands Act which promised new respect for island communities, although I'd argue that whether many islanders feel that respect is anything more than rhetoric. Not enough work has been done to address the backdrop of ageing infrastructure. Whether it's our local inter-island ferries or the CalMac fleet, we see vessels long past their operational lifespans creaking under that load. The consequences are there for all to see. Our procurement must be a major part of any forward-looking strategy, but sadly, this is where the Scottish Government's failings have been most visible. Since the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee concluded its damning report on the issues at Ferguson Marine, things have gone from bad to worse on the banks of the Clyde. On the 30th of September, Ferguson's turnaround director warned the Transport Committee of yet further potential problems and an unquantifiable risk that components in hulls 801 and 802 have deteriorated yet further. It has become a farce, on which I suspect other members will focus their time on this evening. But what is lacking generally is a unified strategic approach on Scotland's ferries. that dares to examine and spell out and cost how long-term sustainability of these vital services will be guaranteed. This requires an acceptance that the current position is expressly unsustainable. The Times noted earlier this year, and I quote, that at the present rate of construction, it would take more than 85 years to replace the entire Calmuc fleet. I'm sure we would all agree, even the Minister, that our communities simply cannot wait that long. My concern is that the problems we see now, largely on the West Coast, are a vision of the future for other island communities. The ferries that serve them continue to be pushed to operate well beyond their projected working life. And when we hear that bodies like the Ferry Industry Advisory Group has not met since October 2019, real concern is understandable. Now, the SNP Scottish Government has a manifesto pledge to introduce an island's connectivity plan, and that's welcome, but the details have been scant so far. An integrated approach is positive, but it must be one that considers ferries in the round and addresses the weaknesses of the 2012 to 2022 plan. From the Northern Isles perspective, the continuing questions of fair funding and RET for Orkney and Shetland must be resolved. And we must also address the importance of ferries carrying freight. For many farmers and fishermen, these links are often what brings their produce to market and makes so many businesses viable. And there should be a clear role and a supportive approach to those independent operators that are also an essential part of our ferries fleet. Deputy Presiding Officer, there is a great deal of anger being felt in communities at the extent of this crisis. Anger justified by the real and present failure in Scotland's approach to ferry connectivity and the many promises that have been made as easily as they have been broken. I've attempted today to be constructive, to outline what is needed for change to happen and the questions that will have to be tackled. But I urge the Scottish Government not to think for one minute that this has escaped the notice of our constituents. They've paid a heavy price in terms of business, opportunities and jobs. They see the threats of closures and depopulation looming and will not be bought off with easy promises of help down the line. What we can do and what we can expect is for the Scottish Government to take ownership of this crisis by admitting that there is a crisis, one that risks getting worse. To set out to this Parliament and to the people in the communities our ferry network serves, how their links will be sustained. Not for tomorrow or for the next financial year, but for the long term. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Graeme Simpson. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Jamie Halcrow-Johnson for securing debating time on this important matter. Scotland's ferry service is perceived to be both unreliable and to lack resilience. Last summer, of the 538 sailings to and from Brodick in July, not one was cancelled. By contrast, in August, COVID-19 infections amongst the crew of the Caledonian Isles and technical problems on the MV Isle of Arran led to the loss of 86 sailings. It is the experience of August, just as capacities were increased, that islanders and visitors remember. Ferry reliability is vital to ensure residents can make essential trips to the mainland and to encourage tourists to visit our islands, which is vital to long-term business survival. Confidence is now at an all-time low. Although many factors are unforeseeable, Calmac's approach to handling bad weather, COVID-19 and technical difficulties present resentment and frustration. Only yesterday we had weather cancellations. However, the Arran Ferry Committee feel there is insufficient flexibility to avoid a default position which restricts supplies and services being delivered in circumstances where the forecast is very likely to result in further cancellations. This should be better recognised to help provide a service to the island. Such challenges need creative customer-centred solutions, and I trust that these are being considered. Island constituents don't accept that cancellation is always the only course of action. It cannot be the case that we head into another winter in the current circumstances. Nor are islanders happy that communication regarding cancellations continues to be haphazard and often late in the day. Particularly now, Arran has only one winter sailing per day from Lochranza to Tarbert for supplies. Other arrangements must be considered. With a high demand for services, the Minister must urgently consider what other resources can be applied to ensure an appropriate service to our island communities. Meanwhile, on the Largs to Cumbrae route, services are halted to deep clean vessels after every third crossing. Calmac prioritised surface cleaning over the risk of airborne transmission of COVID, while pensioners are expected to queue sometimes for up to an hour for tickets. Instead, Calmac should work with Strathclyde Partnership for Transport to allow them to pre-book tickets which show valid concession cards as they board. A simple measure to implement, one would think, and one that would be greatly appreciated by older island constituents. Only a fortnight ago, damage to the hull of the Loch Shira meant that the small Loch Ridden had to take the strain on the Largs to Cumbria route. Queues were long, and once aboard, passengers found the toilets inoperable. The MV Isle of Cumbria also experienced technical difficulties when called to assist, and many irate emails from island constituents ensued. Island constituents continually raised concerns about the lack of community engagement with regards to service timetabling changes and details of the fleet renewal schedule, which Jamie Halcrow-Johnson touched on. CalMac must improve customer service and satisfaction. Port staff are not to blame and are often very helpful, but sometimes bear the brunt of frustrations. The lack of relief staff to work on the island service when COVID outbreaks occur have also contributed to feelings of security, reduced regularity of trips and difficulties in securing bookings on ferries, which always seem to have fully booked card decks. In one instance highlighted to me by the ferry at the Isle of Arran Ferry Committee, a sailing was supposedly fully booked 149 days in advance. In reality, relatively few sailings are fully booked in October. When I last sailed from Brodie a fortnight ago, the card deck was half empty. Yet if you try to book next week, you won't find it easy. The Ferry Committee has repeatedly asked CalMac why this is the case. Island economies are dependent on tourism and therefore the ferry service. Following the pandemic, it's more important than ever to ensure local businesses and communities are supported. Arran's current staff shortages are around three times higher than the mainland average, partly due to concerns over ferry reliability, which makes commuting to the island difficult. It also makes families reluctant to move to the island, necessary to boosting the workforce, economy and sustainable population. Presiding officer, it's vital to ensure that changes CalMac introduce are in the best interests of islanders, dependent on a lifeline service, and issues raised, investigated and acted upon to ensure the service runs as efficiently as possible. Services must handle recurring and preventable issues that continuously leave those living on islands fretting about when they might access and return to the mainland. All parties affected by the liability of services are consulted and must be consulted with, particularly islanders,
Mr. Gibson, could you bring your mic so close, please?
Island connectivity and quality of life. And as for the Minister, I have to say I've always found him available 7 days a week, early in the morning and late at night, whenever he's required. So I'm not really sure about the comments with regard to his holidays. So he's certainly spoken to me when he has been on holiday.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. I now call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Neil Bibby. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Simpson.
Thank you very much. Can I congratulate Jamie Halcrow-Johnson for securing this debate? Can I start by apologising, because I think I may have to leave before the end of the debate, if that's okay. I suspect there'll be quite a lot of speakers.
I don't know, is that, are you asking the chair now, Mr. Simpson?
I am asking for permission.
Normal courtesy would have been to let the chair know before that, but yeah. There we go. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So it's not the first time we've debated ferries. It won't be the last. In fact, we have to. Tells you that there's a problem, and we do have to. Too many islands have suffered through a dismally poor service. Breakdowns are common, and with an ageing fleet, that's not surprising. There's been a chronic lack of investment in ferries over the years, and that's led us to the point that we're at. We just haven't had a proper ferries replacement programme, and now we're playing catch-up. It's exacerbated by the situation at Ferguson Marine, where we have two ferries languishing, years behind schedule and massively over budget. We don't know for certain when they'll be finished. We do know that the nationalised yard is not considered good enough at the moment to bid to build two more ferries. They'll be built in Eastern Europe, and it wouldn't surprise me at all if we see them in service before the Ferguson ones. We're also in the embarrassing situation where we're buying a second-hand ferry from Norway to service the Craig Newer to Oban route. The MV Utna is being sold so the Norwegians can replace her with a zero-emission battery vessel. So we get the gas-guzzling cast-off while they save the planet. We also have to fork out more than £3 million to prepare her to operate here. Quite what the justification is for that price tag is anyone's guess. The government haven't told us. Jamie Halcrow-Johnson rightly says our ferry links are lifelines. He notes the problems over the summer and he recounts the damning report of the former REC committee, which said it, quotes, believes that there's been a catastrophic failure in the management of the procurement of vessels 801 and 802, leading it to conclude that these processes and structures are no longer fit for purpose. And the committee said that there should be a root and branch overhaul of current decision-making structures. They were really talking about, do we need CMAL anymore? The then Minister in charge, Paul Wheelhouse, was completely dismissive of the committee and told them, quotes, "We do not accept the committee's description of a catastrophic failure." Now, Mr. Wheelhouse is no longer here to continue the debate. I suspect that his election leaflet, quoting myself and Alex Rowley, praising him during a debate, not about ferries, helped to put paid to his political career. That's true. Ferries are as vital to Scotland's connectivity as are decent roads and the railways. The government has to accept that things have not been done properly. They must accept there is merit in what we and others, including the REC committee, have been saying, in that we need to A, invest more in ferries, B, award longer contracts so that operators can procure the vessels, and C, consider whether we need SeaMail. This has become a party political football because of failings. My offer to the minister, and this is a genuine offer, is to put myself and maybe others on the ferry industry advisory group that hasn't met for 2 years. I'll even chair it or co-chair it if he wants, so that we can get our islands moving again.
Thank you. I call on Neil Bibby to be followed by Alistair Allen. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For many communities, ferry services are quite literally a lifeline. Their importance is exemplified in the fact that ferry usage has remained high, even in the teeth of the COVID pandemic, more so than other forms of public transport. It's therefore shocking, Presiding Officer, to the extent to which the Scottish Government has for years presided over decline, decay and neglect of Scotland's ferry services, to such an extent that the Times recently reported that the worsening ferry crisis is driving people off islands. There can be no doubt that the CalMac fleet is old and exhausted. It is now prone to breakdowns, delays and chronic disruption. This puts good money after bad. Presiding Officer, and damages reliability so that many in these communities simply cannot any longer rely on these services. The ferry services to Arran and Cumbria are a case in point in my own West Scotland region. Services are operating such a tightrope that a single positive COVID case on the Ardrossan to Brodick route cancelled all sailings on 10th of October and meant the only way on or off Arran was via the route from Lacranza to Kintyre. Just the following day, the Largs Cumbria route was out of commission until evening. A replacement vessel was eventually sent from the Colin Shrive route, but that meant this route in turn had to be cancelled. The ferry serving Colin Shrive, meanwhile, recently broke down for the second time in 3 weeks. This is little wonder, Presiding Officer, when the ferry is 30 years old and counting, 5 years older than the recommended lifespan of a ferry, which is 25 years. And almost half of CalMac's fleet are now over 25 years old and prone to mechanical breakdown. They should be being replaced, not pushed and pressed beyond safe and reliable limits. And a failed bid to try and patch over the enormous ferry failings of this government, which sat idly by whilst unions and experts warned of a perfect storm operating an ageing fleet with growing passenger numbers. In fact, passenger numbers increased by 23% between 2015 and 2019, yet only one large and two small CalMac ferries were introduced in that period. As has already been said, this government has also provided over the fiasco at Ferguson's Marine, such that now we are buying second-hand ferries, as we've heard, from other countries, and a Scottish yard supporting Scottish jobs and owned by the Scottish Government can't even make the shortlist to build new ferries in Scotland. This Government just piles insult upon injury, Presiding Officer. It would be completely unacceptable if there was any further delays in the ferries being currently built at Ferguson's. And I would ask the Minister to confirm today that there will be no further delays to these ferries. And can he explain why he hasn't visited Ferguson's to see the state of the project for himself, because I think that is inexplicable. The government needs to get a grip and finally do the right by our island and coastal communities. We need a national ferry building programme to replace our ageing ferry fleet and to bring jobs to the Lower Clyde and to the communities that have been so ill-served by this government. And as we go forward, there should be representation for passengers and workers in the governance of ferry services. And finally, Presiding Officer, there should be a full review of our ferry services in Scotland to ensure the right vessels are on the right routes at the right time. Thank you.
Thank you. And before calling the next speaker, I would say that due to the number of members who wish to speak in this debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I now invite Jamie Halcrow-Johnson to move a motion without notice.
Happy to move that, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. So the question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? Excellent. I now call Alistair Allen to be followed by Liam MacArthur. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, representing and living in an island constituency which is entirely dependent on CalMac, it would be fair to say that ferries represent the greater part of my daily work at the best of times. It would also be fair to say that this summer was not the best of times. As a result, ferries came quite properly to represent the overwhelming majority of workload for me and my staff. This summer, as we can, I think, all agree, a combination of factors made ferry services nothing short of intolerable. And without minimising any of the problems which members have quite rightly debated, some of those factors were, of course, well beyond normal control, chiefly the fact that vessels were on average running at only a third of their normal capacity due to social distancing requirements. Tourists, of course, have the luxury of booking tickets months in advance. Most other people do not plan their lives that far ahead, nor can they. This summer, that fact led to a very unfortunate tension between the needs of tourists, who are, of course, vital to the island economy, and those of islanders. I live in Lewis, and I'm very aware that this summer, at one point, people simply could not travel anywhere for almost any reason. People elsewhere in Scotland should consider what that might mean for them were such a thing for some unaccountable reason to befall their own mainland town. For me, the low point was reached when people started telling me that they were unable even to visit very ill relatives. I should say that CalMac staff and crews went to great efforts to find ways of transporting people in that situation whenever they complained through me. Now, the most extreme situations like that have eased since the lifting of social distancing restrictions and the tailing off to some extent of the tourist season. However, nobody is under any illusions about all the challenges that lie ahead. As I indicated in my own members' debate some weeks ago, services in the future would be more likely to improve if anyone on the CalMac and CMAL boards actually lived on an island that depended on the ferry services which those companies provide, and the Minister provided, I think, a helpful reply to that debate. Indeed, the Minister, Mr Day, has been a very regular recipient of my emails and phone calls and has been in regular touch, visiting the Western Isles and clearly making real efforts to address some of these issues. So if I can end on a more hopeful note, I hope CalMac's new booking system due in the spring represents an improvement on what everyone acknowledges to be the entirely inadequate booking system that exists now and which Mr Gibson described. I hope that the ongoing review of ferries fares reflects more equitably the deck space that different types of vehicles, including camper vans, actually take up, and that he may be able to say something about these issues in his summing up. The commissioning of two new vessels for Islay and others beyond that, together with the addition of MV Utne, purchased recently in Norway, to the CalMac fleet, will certainly make the fleet more resilient, as will the small vessel building programme budgeted for the years ahead. As the Minister is aware, the challenge is how to add resilience between now and then, and so I hope he will be able to say something more about his efforts in that direction. To conclude, the Minister and the Parliament don't really need me to explain any further the importance which ferries have to every aspect of life in my constituency. And I therefore appreciate this chance to hear from the Government about the plans for the years ahead in order to continue to improve services and ensure, I hope, we don't return to the situation that we faced this summer.
Thank you. I now call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Donald Cameron. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Jamie Halcrow-Johnson on securing another members' debate, this time on my specialist subject of ferries. Growing up in Sandy in the 70s and 80s, I developed a love-hate relationship with the MV Orcadia. She valiantly ploughed the seas around the outer North Isles in Orkney every Monday, Wednesday and Friday. Cargo was loaded using cranes and nets. Livestock often marched on board up gangplanks at the steepest of angles, and weekends home from the school hostel in Kirkwall could often involve 8-hour round trips around every other island before Sandy was finally reached. So Orkney's internal ferry service has come a long way. But now, as then, it remains a critical lifeline for island communities. Now, as then, services must adapt to meet the changing needs of islanders and these communities. Now, as then, these services are crucial in sustaining livelihoods and populations in our smaller isles. So it should concern Scottish ministers that Orkney's Lifeline internal ferry services fall so far below the minimum standards in the government's own National Ferries Plan, published almost a decade ago. This is no criticism of those working for Orkney Ferries who do their level best, but the fact is these services fall below minimum standards on fares, on frequency, and on the accessibility of the vessels themselves. And nor is it a service being run on the cheap, having cost Orkney Islands Council a small fortune over the years. A commitment from Scottish ministers to cover the shortfall in funding is welcome, if overdue, and now subjected, as Jamie Halker-Johnson suggested, to annual horse trading. But we're still no further forward in the procurement of replacement vessels that are now desperately needed. The current fleet is costly to run, increasingly unreliable, and is a disaster in terms of the environment. Unfortunately, CalMac's calamities on the West Coast have grabbed the headlines as well as the attention of ministers. Yet the situation in Orkney is scarcely less precarious. My constituents simply can't afford for ministers to wait until crisis point before action is taken. We can't continue with the mend-and-make-do approach to running Lifeline ferry services. We need a proper, strategic plan, phased procurement of vessels and delivery on time and to budget. And sadly, none of these appear to be strong suits of this government. Presiding Officer, last week CMAL published drawings of a new hydrogen ferry earmarked to operate on the Kirkwall-Chapinsey route at some point in the future. Such innovation is certainly welcome, not least in the context of a climate emergency. But it does not reflect a strategic approach to ferry replacement in Orkney or indeed across Scotland. For 15 years, SNP ministers have failed to grasp either the importance or the urgency of this issue. For the sake of island communities, for islanders, and indeed our hopes of meeting our climate ambitions, that simply cannot continue, and I support the motion this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Donald Cameron to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm grateful, like others, to Jamie Halker-Johnson for securing debate time on this exceptionally important issue. And I acknowledge the contributions made by colleagues from across the chamber. There's obviously a lot of commonality in what we are all saying. But for many, if not all people in the Highlands and Islands, ferry services are lifeline services. They connect families and friends, they allow businesses to function, they help increase tourism, and they are integral to local economies. And whilst that can be said for most modes of transport, our ferry services are different. Not only are they a vital part of island and rural life, but they make living on our islands and remote areas possible. So when these services are cancelled or delayed for sometimes indeterminable periods of time, it not only makes people feel more remote than they often feel already, but it helps increase the rate of depopulation in our island settlements. It adds to a sense of fragility in these places. Now, the Scottish Government has recognised the need to reverse the trend of rural depopulation, and that's welcome. But that government cannot have that worthy ambition and at the same time comprehensively fail to ensure that the very island communities which we seek to revitalise do not possess a robust and reliable ferry service. In the last few months alone, we've seen reports of a series of breakdowns, the breakdown of the MV Loch Seaforth, which serves the critical Stornoway-Ullapool route, and the breakdown of the MV Isle of Cumbrae, which is redeployed following another breakdown, this time of the MV Loch Shearer. We have had breakdown after breakdown after breakdown. And of course, it has to be acknowledged that this government failed to do what CalMAC told it to do back in 2010. And I've referenced this a number of times. It bears repeating. CalMAC told the SNP government that it would have to build a new ferry every year just to stand still. And since the SNP has been in power, it has delivered just 5 new vessels, of which only 2 can be considered major vessels. That's an appalling record. Worse still, some 16 of the 31 active CalMAC vessels are operating beyond their life expectancy of 25 years. The MV Isle of Cumbrae that I've just mentioned is now 45 years old, 20 years in excess of its lifespan. With all things considered, this is a damning failure of this government in its time of office. And as a result, we are in the middle of a ferry crisis. And whilst the evidence of failure is compelling, there is a human cost to this too. As other people have noted, there are hundreds of stories of constituents impacted by the many issues that affect our ferry network, whether it would be ferries breaking down, timetables being altered, delays and cancellations, issues of lack of capacity. Someone from the Western Isles hospitality industry told me she's lost dozens of bookings due to the lack of capacity on the MV Lock Seaforth. Another person from Islay had the same issue. A constituent from Tyree contacted me some time ago when the MV Hebrides had been redeployed elsewhere and the island was left without a service. Or the man from Lewis, who could not get off his own island for 3 weeks this August. He could not leave his home for 3 weeks. In any other scenario, that would be inexcusable. And there are countless stories of people in our island communities. It's not good enough. And yes, there are systemic issues about the structure of CMAL or the operations of CalMAC, like Kenny Gibson mentioned, and that should be looked at. But the blame for this, I am afraid, lies fairly and squarely with the SNP government that has run Scotland's ferries for a decade and a half. As others have noticed, as Jamie Hartcrow-Johnson noticed, we do need a Scotland-wide ferry strategy that will ensure every island community in need of a ferry has access to a proper and reliable service. That is what the people who we represent expect, and that is what they deserve. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Rhoda Grant. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank Jamie Hawker-Johnson for securing this important debate. As an MSP for the Highlands and Islands region, where many of Scotland ferries operate, I am all too aware that the ever-increasing levels of disruption to Scotland's ferry fleets are causing huge distress, in particular to our island communities. Delays, cancellations, unreliability, and a general lack of provision are in great part caused by our ageing fleet and by procurement and bidding processes that are, in the words of Session 5's Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, no longer fit for purpose. The cumulative effect is that there is less employment for islanders, additional barriers to living on and doing business on islands, and a deterrent to tourism, all at a time when island communities and industries have been hit harder than most by the pandemic. But there is also another problem with Scotland's ferries. The majority run on diesel, which is carbon intensive and damaging to our marine environment. There is growing recognition that this needs to change as COP26 approaches and we all focus in on the nature and climate emergencies. I agree that there is an urgent need for a Scotland-wide ferries strategy, ideally sooner than the publication of the Islands Connectivity Plan in 2023. The technology and the ideas for improvement exist, but we need investment, leadership, and a long-term strategy from government. I'd like to see the strategy include the following. As has been called for, of course, we need to expand and upgrade Scotland's ferry fleet. New vessels should be zero or low carbon, such as the electric ferries running on renewable energy in Sweden and Denmark, or Europe's first green hydrogen ferry, which is currently being designed in Scotland, plus more diesel-electric hybrid ferries, until we can phase out diesel completely. But we must also decarbonise our existing vessels. Retrofitting an electric motor to a diesel ferry is a win-win, as it cuts pollution, emissions, noise, and running costs. by procuring more passenger-only ferries and improving connections with buses and trains, we can future-proof our fleet for increasing levels of active and low-carbon travel by residents and visitors. The Scottish Greens have called for an end to the costly operator bidding process, which eats into CalMac's time and resources every 6 years and inhibits longer-term planning. Without that, government and CalMac could take a much more strategic approach to improving and greening our ferry services, ensuring alignment with our climate and biodiversity targets, and enabling far more people to enjoy living and working on our islands. And finally, for islanders, ferries are like buses, and I would ask the Minister to extend the free bus services to free ferries to under 26. I urge the Scottish Government to consider this need for a Scotland-wide ferry strategy as called for by Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, and I support this motion. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Edward Mountain. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too would like to congratulate Jamie Halcrow-Johnston for securing this debate. Ferries are lifelines to our island communities, and if they don't sail, it affects every aspect of island life. I watched in horror over the weekend when there was a relentless stream of cancellations and disruptions, some due to COVID, but mostly due to technical issues, dry docking and the knock-on impact of these. Add to that, ferries that are providing temporary cover for these routes are not designed for them, and therefore they're unable to sail in bad weather. We need ferries built and designed for several routes so that they are suitable to cover for broken down ferries or those having routine maintenance. This current situation simply can't go on. The Scottish Government have failed to manage these services effectively, and that failure is causing untold misery to those who live on our islands. And this is just the beginning of the winter, but almost two-thirds of the Clyde and Hebridean ferry routes were subject to cancellation or change over the last few days. How on earth can people plan their lives with that level of disruption? The motion pertains to the Clyde and Hebrides services, but there are also issues in the Northern Isles that have been ongoing for years, as Jamie Halcrow-Johnston and Liam MacArthur spoke about. The inter-island ferry services, those boats need replaced, and the freight service to the mainland is not coping with demand. Again, a failure on the part of the Scottish Government. And this is not due to a lack of investment, and indeed the money squandered by this government is eye-watering. Had it been spent properly, it would have replaced the whole fleet. There's also a huge degree of arrogance directed towards those communities from the Scottish Government and their agencies. When communities make suggestions, their ideas are ignored. Given they use these services, they are best placed to know what would work, and yet they're ignored. Community in Mull found a vessel for themselves. They had research carried out on how it could be made fit for purpose, yet they were ignored. Another ferry has been procured for that route, which is of course welcome, but the one they had identified would have been infinitely better. When the people in Lewis asked for two smaller ferries rather than one large one, they were ignored. Yet had two smaller ferries been provided, many of the issues that we now face would have been negated. We would have had a spare ferry in the winter to cover dry docking, when, due to a lower demand on the Stornoway-Ullapool route, one ferry would cover that route itself. That ferry, built for the Stornoway route, would have been able to withstand the adverse weather conditions on almost every other route. The figures showing cancellations due to weather give a false impression. It's not due to weather itself, but rather due to ferries on the route during the winter not being designed to withstand these conditions on that route. Presiding Officer, I continually warn the Scottish Government on behalf of my constituents of these issues, and yet they ignore everyone. It is that arrogance that has led to this sorry state. However, they are not facing the brunt of the anger and frustration of the travelling public. Sadly, it's the staff who provide these services that hear that. even without facing the anger and frustration, knowing firsthand that services are being cancelled and stopping people getting to hospital appointments, to sick relatives, to family funerals, is incredibly stressful, especially if you are part of that community. Add to that the empty supermarket shelves that caused by missed deliveries. Simply not fair. The Scottish Government are letting down the hard-working staff. I appeal to people not to take out their frustrations on staff whose own lives are impacted by this mismanagement. Instead, they should tell the government of their frustrations and the impact of this on their daily lives. The Scottish Government's answer to all of this has been a review to kick the can further down the road while our communities suffer. Frankly, everyone knows the issues and they don't need a review to tell them what's wrong. Presiding officer, it's long past being an emergency and the minister must act to save these communities from catastrophe.
Thank you. And I now call Edwin Mountain, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Beatrice Wishart. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Mountain.
Thank you very much, presiding officer. And I'd like to thank my colleague, Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, for securing this important debate. It's no exaggeration to say the current ferries crisis is a disaster for islanders and for Scotland, and I agree with so much of what has been said in the chamber today. In the last 15 years, the SNP have failed to renew our ferry fleet, and we've left, as we've heard, with 16 ships over the age of 25 years old. Now, this whole sorry saga of mismanagement of the ferries makes it likely that it could become a film. The title would obviously be called Carry On Without the Ferries, with a working title perhaps of £300 million spent with no boats delivered. Now, this farce is being funded by the people of Scotland at the expense of islanders. Of course, Transport Scotland are the directing agents, and they're ably assisted in this by Seamail. Now, the actors in this farce are numerous, and some deserve special mention. First of all, perhaps Alex Salmon, who played a key role in Jim McCall's takeover of Ferguson Shipyard. Of course, the First Minister, who announced the £97 million ferry contract, who went on to launch Hull 801 with wooden windows, dummy funnels and no engines. Hamza Youssef, who was Transport Minister, failed to manage the contracts for either 801 or 802 and had no idea they were so far behind schedule. Derek Mackay is obviously a key player, having signed off £127 million of payments to Ferguson Marine, made up of 85% of the contract payments for both ferries and a £45 million loan that Seamail didn't even know about and only ended up with half of one ferry, which wasn't even fit for purpose. Michael Matheson and Paul Wheelhouse both announced delay after delay to both vessels, but still argued everything was fine and on budget. Fiona Hislop, who claimed Ferguson's had a bright future ahead of it, despite the fact that they wouldn't be allowed to tender for any more ferries in the meantime. And of course, Kate Forbes, who is a ministerial responsibility for Tim Hare, the turnaround director of Ferguson's, who is paid £2,850 per week, or has nearly received over £1 million in payment, having never reviewed his contract, oblivious to the fact that he has yet to deliver either vessel, or the previous company that he was turnaround director went into receivership. And Graham Day, who we've heard already, is now in charge, has failed to meet Tim Hare or even visit the shipyard during the summer after his appointment. And then finally, Ivan McKee, who admittedly has a very small walk-on part, but when challenged to defend the litany of failures, said, and I quote, "These things happen." And I'm sorry that I've heard to report that I've heard that the Scottish Government has now been nominated for the Cash Cow Award for awarding a £97 million contract that will likely cost in excess of £300 million. If they win, I wonder who'll be asked to collect it. I don't suppose there's many volunteers or many members in the Cabinet who haven't had a role in the past. It is an expensive failure and far from a joke, presiding officer. Expensive to the people of Scotland and to the islanders who rely on our ferries and desperately need new ones. Because in the last years, and let's get these figures right, our ferries have had 99 breakdowns and major disruptions to services, culminating in nearly 6,000 cancelled sailings. And I'm sure I don't need to remind the Parliament that the REC committee, which I was convener of, concluded this fiasco was caused by a catastrophic failure in the management and the procurement of vessels. And it also criticised the government for not having a ferries plan. It never seems to have had one. Presiding officer, a resilient network of ferries is vital for the future of our island community. For that to happen, we need a new Scotland-wide ferry strategy. And even more importantly, we need a Scottish government that can deliver it. After 15 years of failure, it's time for this SNP to improve on their dismal record on failures. Our islanders desperately need the government to up their game.
Mr. Mount, could you bring your remarks to a close, please? You are a bit over time. Thank you.
Indeed, Presiding Officer, my real concern is that I don't believe this government is capable of doing so. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Katie Clark. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to Jamie Halkra-Johnson for securing this important debate. Islanders know the vital importance of Scotland's ferry services, regardless of which island community they serve. While people in the Central Belt rely on roads for their connectivity to business and social activities, island communities must rely on their lifeline services to do the same. Caring responsibilities, hospital appointments, and social situations, including funerals, weddings, and holidays, all rely on robust ferry services. The same can be said for visitors to the Isles too. The strong tourism officer islands have built up over many years also rely on robust ferry services. The impact of unreliable services cannot be underestimated. Its impact is felt across the community, socially, culturally, and economically. Shetland has growing seafood and aquaculture sectors, and with new fish markets, landings are likely to continue to increase. However, despite growth amongst key local sectors, the government has failed to take this into account and deliver adequate freight capacity. This is despite warnings that I and local industry leaders have raised repeatedly with Transport Scotland and ministers about the growing freight capacity difficulties. Because if products do not reach their destination on time, that impacts not only on the quality of perishables like salmon and other seafood, but on the producers' markets. The customer is king, but they can be lost, and once lost, they are unlikely to return. The commercial pressures faced by producers, hauliers and their customers are, to quote one industry leader, quite intolerable. Pinch points over the livestock season have also been known about for years. They are clearly known and foreseen. Earlier this summer, Liam MacArthur and I warned about possible further disruption after the MV Arrow, previously serving Northern Isles routes, was chartered to assist CalMac. This came just weeks before the Northern Isles peak season for the movement of livestock. However, this is about more than just pinch points. The government does not appear to recognise the contradiction in its policies of encouraging growth in food produce sectors on one hand, while on the other it is stifling the very means by which products can be exported to the waiting global markets. When questioned about the failure to ship trailers when needed during the livestock period, the response has been that all trailers were shipped across the week. However, saying across the week demonstrates a lack of commercial understanding of how these markets work. If trailers are not shipped on time, the knock-on impact is very real, with local firms at risk of being hit by costly overnight levies, all the while as their trailers sit underutilised on the quayside. This happens repeatedly, despite local stakeholders feeding back information to Transport Scotland. In terms of information, it would be helpful if the Minister could tell me what evidence Transport Scotland has on unmet need on both the freight and passenger service for the Northern Isles. How many times have companies been unable to ship their trailers or other vehicles at the time they needed? Is there any system in place to record unmet need? The number of times customers, whether business or domestic, cannot get the bookings they need. Just this week, I heard from a constituent who was advised by Northlink Ferries that they cannot book their January travel because they, Northlink, are waiting to hear from Transport Scotland before they can open up bookings. Presiding Officer, January is just 9 weeks away. I've previously highlighted the case of a removals firm who had their ferry bookings cancelled at short notice. Their business reputation is just as important as other companies. The construction of the Viking Energy wind farm is underway in Shetland, and that means an increased volume of incoming freight. Any delay in getting construction materials into Shetland on time because of freight capacity constraints could impact contractual obligations throughout the supply chain. And I note Viking's reference to sea freight restrictions in the latest edition of Building Shetland's Energy Future. Then there's the current policy with concessionary ferry vouchers that has reduced the islander eligibility from 2 free return trips a year to 1. I could continue at some length, but time is against me. Suffice to say that islanders recognise the vital importance of Scotland's ferries, and it's long past time that the Scottish Government acted as if they do too.
Thank you. And I now call Katie Clark to be followed by Jenny Minto. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Clark.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This debate highlights the crisis facing Lifeline Ferries, largely created by the failure to invest in the renewal of the fleet over the last 14 years, but also by poor decision-making. Most industry experts agree, as has been said, that the average life expectancy of a ferry is around 25 years, yet half of the 31 working state-owned vessels are older than that. More than 1,000 ferry sailings have been delayed in the last 5 years due to mechanical reasons, and only 5 new ferries have been fully delivered to Calmac since 2007, and only 2 of these on major routes. That compares with 12 vessels that were launched in the 14 years up to 2007. So whilst the management of the project to build the 2 Lifeline vessels at Ferguson Marine has been shambolic and indeed is a disgrace, that is not the only problem that we have here, and we need to learn from the mistakes that have been made and learn lessons for the future. CMAL scouring the globe for second-hand vessels or out of desperation seeking to charter vessels such as MV Pentalina from anti-union operators is not the solution to the challenge that we face. And I think what the Parliament has to agree and appreciate is that the reason we're in this situation is because of a long-term failure to invest and to plan in new vessels. The current structures, however, are a mess and are dysfunctional. CMAL owns the ferries. Calmac operates most of them. But the ports are owned by trusts, private companies or public bodies, depending on where you go. So we have a fragmented structure. North Ayrshire Council is willing to take Adrosson Harbour into municipal ownership, given that there has been considerable delays of more than 4 years in getting the private owner of the relevant land to agree to what is required to develop Adrosson Harbour. And I appreciate the Scottish Government's position in terms of wanting to get the best deal for the taxpayer. But, of course, at the end of the day, it is those that rely on this service and, indeed, the communities of Adrosson and Arran that suffer. In 2017, the Scottish Government said it would build the case for making a direct award to an in-house operator for the Clyde and Hebrides services. Earlier this year, the Scottish Government was unable to confirm whether this was still its intention. I hope today that the Scottish Government will be able to confirm that they intend to go down this path and that they will urgently produce a Scottish-wide ferry strategy to commission new fleet, but also to integrate the fragmented structures which have led to poor decision-making. The Scottish Government brought in their flagship RET policy after they won the election in 2007. And of course, that did cut fares, but it also led to a significant increase in passenger numbers. And that additional stress on the surface was not planned for and was not resourced. I believe that we are in a situation where now an urgent plan is required. We need an urgent plan that recognises that we need long-term solutions that ensure that we have vessels commissioned, ideally in Scotland, that will be commissioned and launched over the next 20 years, and that the Scottish Government put before Parliament detailed proposals that those who have experience can scrutinise and debate.
Thank you. And I now call Jenny Minto, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond to the debate. Ms Minto, up to 4 minutes, please.
Okay. Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too would like to thank Jamie Halcrow-Johnson for securing this debate. Mr Halcrow-Johnson's motion is correct in recognising the importance of lifeline ferry links to Scotland's island communities. And I was pleased that he also included in his contribution the importance of connections mainland to mainland, such as Campbelltown to Ardrossan and Dunoon to Gourock. I would also like to thank and recognise the fantastic work that the CalMac staff do both onshore and aboard vessels to make people's journeys as safe and enjoyable as possible. The current problems on the services have made this job more difficult, juggling the different travel needs and expectations of locals, businesses, visitors and public services. Now, I wasn't in Parliament when the REC debate took place, but I watched it on television. I was struck by the consensus across the chamber from all parties contributing to the debate, all with solutions, possible solutions. The ferry issue is a huge one and has clearly been raised by everybody that has spoken in this debate. And I think we also need to recognise the number of sailings that are happening on a daily basis that do leave on time and do complete their service. I'm like Alistair, have been able to have conversations with the Minister on a regular basis, bringing to him issues that my constituents have raised. The delays directly impact on businesses' bottom lines and can cause logistical problems, as Beatrice Wishart mentioned. It impacts people with hospital visits. I too would be interested to know the progress of the new passenger booking system with regards to unmet demand. Last week I spent visiting different locations across my constituency where I met with ferry groups, farmers, businesses and individuals, and it will come as no surprise to everybody in the chamber that they raise concerns and a deal of anger about ferry services to me. So I'll be writing to the Transport Minister in much more detail about the points that these were raised, but I think it's important to give a flavour of people's lived experiences. The haulier who couldn't get a booking on a ferry to get cattle feed onto Isla. Farmers that can't get their livestock to market from Mull. B&B owners, as Donald Cameron noted, who were losing bookings. Those that don't have credit or debit cards, who can't buy things on board, as it's still only card only. Those with hospital appointments on the mainland who can't get car space. But as I have said, I have been able to speak to the Minister about these issues, as have my constituents, and these difficult questions we're both asking of CalMac and CMAL. There have been small but important improvements. The requirement of camper vans to have a booking and not sit in standby queues has made a difference to local people who have wanted to travel at short notice. And the reduction in cost for school minibuses taking island youngsters to the mainland for sporting and cultural events is very welcome. And I also hope that a solution is close to being found to ensure that space is allocated specifically for locals. There have been some improvements that have happened recently. Alistair Allen mentioned the two ferries currently for the Isla route and also the purchase for the MV Utney. I'm slightly lost at the fact that on one hand the Tory benches complain that we've got a poor service, yet when something is done they still complain. This year, the Scottish Government has provided an increase of £7.7 million in grant support for inter-island ferries and committed to maintain RET. I have reservations too about the current structures, but I'm confident that the Island Connectivity Plan, which will be published at the end of 2022, will deliver good outcomes for communities. And the Minister will take the necessary action in creating the best integrated transport system for the communities who rely on them.
Thank you. And I would now ask Minister Graeme Day to respond to the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin by making clear that the Scottish Government fully recognises the importance of our ferry services, from the lifeline services delivered for the residents of our island communities to the support that ferries offer to island-based businesses, including those that depend on tourism. We understand, I understand, the frustration and potential economic impact during periods of disruption. Regarding the recent issues on the Clyde and Hebrides service, I want to make it clear that we absolutely get that these issues were unacceptable to island communities. Now, whilst every effort is made to avoid breakdowns, it's impossible to completely remove the risk of this happening in technically complex vessels, and yes, some elderly vessels. It's also the case that during times of disruption, CalMac ferries strive to deliver additional sailings and redeploy vessels, if appropriate and possible to do so. But when the impacts cannot be fully mitigated, then I totally understand the anger felt by those directly impacted. And I can assure you that I remain focused on the underlying issues around resilience on the ferry network, and that we are working closely with operators in this regard. And I think Kenny Gibson made a very good point about communications. You know, I think islanders will accept at times that things happen, but I don't necessarily accept that the operator has always been as on point as they might have been in terms of communication, and I do hope we're starting to see some improvement in that regard. But to help these issues, the Scottish Government established a resilience fund in 2018-19 to invest in ferry services to ensure future reliability and availability of vessels. This funding is over and above the annual expenditure for maintenance and repairs and assists to ensure future reliability and availability of vessels. And it can be invested in securing spare parts that have long lead-in times, but equally it can be used to replace obsolete systems to avoid vessels going out of service, and we continue to invest on this basis. Additionally, CalMac has now established a long-term yard strategy. These contracts allow for closer working relationships between CalMac and the respective yards, improved planning of overhaul work, improved remedies against delays and incentives for continuous improvement. CalMac are confident, and I expect this to be delivered, that the contracts will see a tangible benefit for island communities, delivering more resilient ferry services whilst we pursue the replacement programme. It has been a challenging summer, with additional operational demands on top of continued impacts of COVID. As restrictions have eased, we've seen outbreaks amongst crews, which have understandably led to disruption of timetables. And I do gently say to Kenny Gibson that when this happens, deep cleaning inevitably is needed, as is testing of the crews. And I know he knows that. The pandemic has been hard on CalMac staff, and I hope the Chamber, and I know they will because I've heard some of the comments, would support me in thanking the frontline operatives who've been working flat out throughout this time to support travellers. I've met and heard directly from some of the ferry crews and the ticket office staff across the network over recent months, and I've been saddened, in fact angered, to hear of instances of both being subject to abusive behaviour. It should be said that for the overwhelming part, these have been isolated instances. Nevertheless, let me be clear, hard-working CalMac staff should not be being subjected to any form of abuse. Turning to the situation with NIFs, let me firstly also thank the staff delivering that service. Again, I met with some of them whilst visiting Orkney, and I want to place on record my appreciation of their efforts across the pandemic. Let me say also that we are entirely aware of the pressures that have been highlighted around freight on the Northern Isles services, and that's why we are working towards replacement vessels. Whilst we recognise the pressures, particularly at peak livestock season, Northlink have worked hard, along with businesses, to ensure that just-in-time products have been accommodated and that all freight shipments have been carried timeously over the recent annual busy period. And we are, as I said, working towards the provision of new freight vessels with larger capacity and shorter journey times. And in the interim, we continue to look at initiatives and chartering opportunities to alleviate the current situation. Turning to the construction and procurement of ferry vessels in Scotland, my predecessor took part in a debate on this topic in February, highlighting the range of actions that we are committed to take towards continuous improvement. My colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy, has been keeping the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee up to date on the progress with the vessels currently under construction at Ferguson's and which sit within her remit. I've also recently written to the committee to provide an update on actions taken to improve ferry procurement.
Katie Clark. Ms Clark, your microphone's not on. You might want to start again with your card in. Thank you. That's it. Thank you, Ms Clark.
I apologise to everybody. I have been asking Ferguson Marine Shipyard Management for a number of months if I could visit and to hear their side of the story. They're much criticised, and there's a, you know, a great deal of public money obviously involved in this project. I understand it may be that they don't want to just facilitate a visit for one MSP, but I believe other MSPs also would be interested in visiting. Would he give support to us in visiting the shipyard to find out more about what's happening with these contracts?
Minister.
Officer, as the member knows, the responsibility in this area sits with my colleague Kate Forbes, but I'm happy to pass that request on to her. Building on lessons learned, CMAL are procuring the procuring authority of new vessels for the ferry networks has strengthened processes to include additional diligence and independent verification of the financial standing and ability to deliver of preferred bidders. Financial monitoring will continue to be undertaken prior to any contract award and continued at appropriate stages throughout the contract period. CMAL have also committed to obtaining further support from independent technical consultants to work alongside their experienced in-house team when undertaking technical assessments during the procurement process. And that responds to the REC committee report. These actions and others are now embedded in the approach on new procurements. The motion before us calls for a ferries strategy, but we have the ferries plan, supported by the vessel replacement and deployment plans from 2018. And more recently, we set up out up-to-date investment plans in the infrastructure investment plan in February of this year, which identifies, I want to make progress if I may, which backed up by £580 million of investment, a five-year pipeline of vessel and harbour projects, and we're working hard to deliver them. This builds on previous investment of £2 billion in ferry operations and infrastructure. But I recognise that this is more than the next 5 years. This is going to have to be a much more long-term approach, and that is what we're committed to delivering. We're actively moving forward with delivery, showcased by the commitment to a second new Isla vessel, which demonstrates our determination to add resilience to the fleet as a whole, including through the consequent redeployment of the Finnlagan, which is bringing benefits elsewhere in the network. And that will be in addition to the Glen Sannox and the sister ship 802. Significant process... I will.
Liam MacArthur.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for taking the intervention. He's referred to the ferry plan, which I know exists, but I also know that it makes very clear how the internal ferry services in Orkney fall significantly below those minimum standards. He's referred to the additional vessels being added on the West Coast. Can he update the Chamber on what progress is being made to ensure that the services in Orkney, upon which my constituents are reliant, do meet at least those minimum standards, if not better?
Minister?
Well, I want to come to that in a minute. As I said, the progress is being made on the Gourock, Dunoon, Kilcreggan vessel project and the small vessel replacement programme, and work has begun on other future major vessel projects for Craig New Robin, Mallaig, Lough Boisdale, as well as the replacement of the two freight vessels for the Northern Ireland services. Now, members are right to hold ministers to account for shortcomings in the ferry network that we are responsible for. But equally, they need to recognise that responsibility for inter-island ferries lies with the relevant local authorities. Now, as I've indicated before to Liam MacArthur and others, we are prepared to assist where we reasonably can, perhaps in the form of assistance on design, etc., on the chiefs that can sit alongside the CHIFs and NIFs contracts that we are responsible for. And we will continue to work with local authorities in that space. But let us be clear, this for the local authorities are responsible for the replacement of these ferries. I've also been clear in my engagement, extensive engagement with communities and in response in the Chamber that we've heard the views, strong views of stakeholders and are actively exploring further future vessel appointment, recognising that. Presiding Officer, if you will indulge me, because I have a lot to respond to.
Minister, I think that's very generous of you, but we do have a deadline certainly of 6:45-46,
oh, we shall be finished before then, Presiding Officer.
Excellent.
Thank you for your indulgence. Now, we recognise that this new tonnage will take time to come into service, which is why we continue to task CMAL with sourcing additional second-hand vessels to improve services and bring additional resilience to the fleet serving the Clyde and Hebrides and the Northern Isles. I was delighted to announce that MV Utney has been purchased by CMAL. That purchase is proof that we can, where we can, we will take steps to improve matters now. And I do gently point out, as Jenny Minto did, that we're criticised for insufficient capacity in the fleet, then criticised for taking steps to alleviate the situation, either by purchase or time charter. Now, members have touched upon the island's connectivity plan. We are preparing that as a replacement for the ferries plan and very much taking account of the views of the communities in that regard. It will include an even longer term investment programme for new ferries and developments at ports, because Katie Grant's right to talk about the port situation. She absolutely is. This is something that we need to address. We need to improve resilience, reliability, capacity and accessibility, and increase standardisation, cutting emissions and meeting the needs of island communities while providing value for money.
Minister, I don't want to interrupt the flow, but I do feel that it is excellent that several interventions were taken and duly responded to at some length, but equally I think the initial time that you had was 7 minutes, the Minister had.
So
I think we should be
officer.
Looking to bring to availability on the part of every speaker. Thank you.
So I just want to finish by highlighting the fact that there have been improvements of late. The purchase of the Utney, measures around school minibuses, the thorny issue of motorhome carriage, and enhancing the role of the community board. I think that refutes the idea that either I or my officials are arrogant when it comes to responding to reasonable suggestions and asks from communities. Presiding officer, to conclude, there is much more to do. I recognise that. But I think we have demonstrated over these past few months that we absolutely get the need for improvement, and more importantly, are taking the tangible steps to deliver that.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.